think it really would say at this point, you know, if you're going to be a team that's functioning at a fairly high level, you know, whether that's competitively or in your outreach activities, you know, being a big part of your community, key to that is going to be communications and public relations. You know, you see all the teams, 254, 1114, you know, 1118, you know, all those teams that are, you know, not only are they competitive, but they also have very good communications channels that they use very effectively. So what are the components of your public relations program? I mean, they're all pretty basic. I imagine most of you guys are doing most of these things. Press releases. I'm going to talk a little bit more in depth about press releases because it's probably, it's probably one of the most common things you're going to use, but it also is probably one of the more difficult things to put together because people aren't familiar with it. There's a very specific style and format and things like that that go along with press releases. So it's a little different from some of the other kinds of media channels you're going to use. So newsletters, you know, I imagine most of your teams have a newsletter, something that you get out to, you know, your friends and family and the people who are involved with your team. Your website, obviously, which is really important. And then a lot of the social media outlets, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, whatever other platforms you guys are using and you know, how you're using them. So that all becomes a part of your, you know, public relations and communications program. So I said I was going to talk a little bit about writing, and so here, come on in. Lots of seats down front. I won't spit on you. So I'm going to talk a little bit about writing, because that's something that's kind of near and dear to my heart. So every type of communications you do has a different voice. And I think this is a really, really important thing to think about when you're writing for different types of media. So, you know, press releases are factual and they're written in the third person. So, you know, your newsletter is less formal, it's probably more personal. So like if you're going to go back and you're going to put something in a newsletter, you're probably going to talk about, you know, we're really excited to be at Capital City Classic this weekend. We had a great time playing with our friends in the quarterfinals. That's not the kind of thing you're going to write for a press release. You know, press release is going to be, you know, Buchanan Bird Brains won, Ada, you know, was ranked second out of in our group, and we went on to the finals today and, you know, received an award at Capital City Classic. So it's going to be more fact-based. It's going to be written in the third person. Like I said, your newsletter is something that's more chatty. You're talking to your friends. You're talking to people who know more about you. And your social media, obviously, is going to be very conversational. It's short, it's conversational. It's probably something you're most comfortable doing in a lot of ways, so it's probably going to be a lot easier. But still, you need to, you know, keep a professional tone to whatever you're putting out there on social media, because that does represent your team. You know, so you do need to be careful about what you write, how you write it, you know, making sure that you're not, you know, using too many, you know, too many things that wouldn't be understood by other people, you know, a general audience. So, you know, keeping a professional tone is important because, you know, it's going to be more conversational. So you need to tailor your writing style to the audience that you're reaching with each of those media channels, because they're all different. You know, the people you're reaching through all those, there's some overlap, obviously, but for the most part, you're reaching different kinds of people. So your newspaper audience, you're writing a press release that's going to go out about an upcoming event, or you're going to talk about a competition, or you're going to recap what you did at a competition. Most of the people who are going to read that in the newspaper don't know anything about robotics, don't know anything about FIRST, don't know anything about the game you're playing, may know who you are, but probably don't know very much about what you do. So you need to keep it pretty basic. What I've been working with students on, like doing a recap from one of the last Chessy Champs. You can't really get down into, you know, the specifics of the game or really even the scoring or things like that, because it's just too much detail. It's not going to make it into the final thing that's going to appear in the paper. So, you know, you need to keep it basic. You need to understand that most of the audience doesn't know a lot. You need to explain the terms you're using. You probably need to explain what FIRST is. You probably need to explain what your team is. You know, your newsletter is aimed at people who know who you are. So there is a place where you can be more technical. You can be more, provide more specifics about the game or what you did or, you know, what you were involved with. Because those people are going to understand it. And then the social media audiences, again, they're probably the most currently informed. These are people who know you pretty well. They're following you on Facebook or they're following you on Twitter. They probably know more about robotics and more about what you're doing. So you can have a little bit more specific information. But it's really important to understand it's not a one style fits all. You know, every time you're looking at something, you know, the voice you're using for a press release is different from the voice you're using in your social media, which is different from maybe what you're going to put on your website, which is different from what's going to be in your newsletter. So every time you're putting that information together, think about who your audience is, you know, and think about what you're communicating and how you're communicating it. And again, all the time, no matter what you're using, you do want to keep it professional. You're representing your team, you're representing your team, your community, and your sponsor. So it's always good to keep that in mind. So press releases. So we'll go over a little bit on, you know, what the format and what these are about. Because it's a very specific kind of format. And it's something that, like I said, most people probably, you know, in high school, you don't get a lot of opportunity to work on this. So if you go out and you look on the web and, you know, look up press release format, you're going to see a lot of things that the design of them is different. You know, there's going to be, you know, different ways people use fonts or headlines or things like that. But if you look at them all, they're pretty consistent in the format. And, you know, amazingly, the format that you see now as being what's a preferred format for press releases is pretty much the same format I started using when I first started working. It hasn't really changed a whole lot, even though now most everything, you know, you're submitting it electronically. Most editors are still looking for it in a very specific format. So the basics of press releases, and I'm sure you guys have probably heard this in your writing classes over the years, is you're answering the five W's, which is really who, what, where, why, when. Okay, so you really need to get that right up front. Those are your most important things that you're going to get into a press release when you're talking about your event, or even if you're going to recap an event, or you're talking about an upcoming you know, opportunity to interact with the team or something you're doing. You know, pretty much those five things are always going to be in there one way or another. When you do your press release, you want to keep to the facts. Again, this is just talking about voice. You know, what is the way that you are communicating with your audience? It's very fact-based. You know, this is what's happening. This is when it's happening. This is who's involved. These are the kinds of things we're doing. And again, you know, keep your audience in mind. How much are they really going to know about the subject you're talking about? You know, maybe it's a competition. Maybe it's an outreach event. Maybe it's a demo. Whatever it is, you know, you have to think about what will they really know. And so you need to give them the background information as best you can. So, and then one of the big things that you really need to think about too is why should they be interested? Okay, you're obviously interested in it. Excuse me for a moment. You know, you're interested in it, but you need to understand, you know, why is your audience going to be interested in it? So what is it about the activity, the event, that means something to your audience? So try and find out, you know, what that is. You know, and make it interesting. I mean, it has to be fact-based. It has to be something that, you know, represents what you did. But you can also make it interesting. I mean, put enough things in there that, you know, will make it interesting to the audience so that they care about it. You know, it's a local robotics team. It involves so many students from, you know, local high schools. You know, we were involved with working with other teams from other places, and where were they from, and what did we do? You know, but you make it interesting, but again, keep to the facts. So this is kind of a sample press release format. Again, if you look out there, I've included a link to some resources at the end. This is pretty much the way most press releases need to be set up and what most people are looking for. So up here, for media release, okay, it seems obvious, but for editors, it's not always an obvious thing. They want to know that the information you send them, they can use right away. So typically what you do is you say for media release. Something that we used to do, when I used to work, so I originally started out working for a symphony orchestra. And every year we would do an announcement about our season coming up. And so we would send the information to the press earlier before we made our big announcement about the season. And what we would say is embargoed to such and such a date, which just meant don't use this until that date. But what they want to see in here is for immediate release tells them that you can go ahead and use this, it's all ready to go. You always want to have a contact name on there, and a, you know, a good way for them to contact you. So your phone number, your email address, it's really critical. They need to have somebody to talk to, because if they go through it, they have questions, they want to follow up, they want to do something else, they need to know who to get to. So right at the top, have your contact on it. Headline, pretty obvious, but you know, needs to be something that gets their attention. you know, that it says, you know, that they know what it's about, gives them enough information so that they can figure out what's in the rest of it. This is obviously pretty abbreviated. This is taken from one of the press releases that, you know, we put together for the competition. You know, your first couple paragraphs are really what they need to know. Or, you know, and you start off usually with this, you know, where it is, where this is coming from, or where the event's about. So the date is California, October 10th, 2015, and when we sent it out. And then it says, more than 20 revised teams from beyond California participate in the Capital City Classic revised competition on October 24 and 25 at Davis High School. So right there, who's going, when's it gonna be, what's happening? And then a little more information here about who's attending, a little bit more interest about it. And then one thing it's always good to have in all your press releases is just a standard boilerplate statement about your team. You know, ideally FIRST would like you to have information about FIRST in there as well. But you know, it's gonna be a paragraph or two that says, who are you, what is FIRST? And where do you get more information about your team? And that should be just a standard paragraph or two paragraphs that always goes at the end of your press release. You know, you can just say, you know, about, you know, Eagle Force Robotics, about Buchanan Bird Brains, about Circuit Breakers. And then just have those couple of paragraphs in there. And so those are pretty consistent, so that whenever, you know, it's information for the editor, so they know what it's all about, gives them a little bit more background, maybe information they incorporate into whatever ends up in the paper. But, you know, just have that written and have it available so you can use it, you know, whenever you send out a press release. So any questions on all that? And if you guys have questions, feel free to jump in anytime. Just because I'm talking doesn't mean that I don't have to stop. So any questions about kind of this format and what this is all about? Is this kind of format you guys all use? Is everybody pretty familiar with this? No? Yes? No? Okay. But this is pretty much one of the, and I said there's a lot of resources out there that you can get these formats so that you can see, you know, have something you can plug into. So kind of went over all this. So it's one of the things that they always talk about when you write press releases, it's an inverse pyramid style. So, you know, your most important information is up here, your least important information up here. So you start with what's really important, and as you kind of go through, less important, less important, less important. Because what most editors will do, if it's well written, then they don't have to do a lot with it, which is also important. They'll take it, if they need to cut for space, they're gonna cut from the bottom. So they'll take out what's on the bottom, they're gonna use the stuff on top because they figure that's the most important. And the better, this is actually kind of a key thing, the better you can write your press release and the more in this kind of a format and the way of presenting your information, the more likely that's gonna make it into the newspaper. If they can get that press release, look at it, say, it's well written, it's got the information I need to put in the newspaper to advertise your event or to, you know, give you publicity about how you did it at a competition or something, the more that's actually gonna make it into the newspaper. You can include quotes as appropriate. Quotes are a great way to add some interest to your press releases. Now, this is kind of something that I know some people get shocked at, but don't be afraid to make up quotes for people. You know, a lot of people say, oh, you know, they went, I remember years ago there was something that somebody found out about, well, the president actually didn't say a quote that was in, you know, that somebody had like written a quote for the president that showed up and something. It's like, well, you can pretty much figure 90% of what you see as quotes for important people in press releases and news stories were written by somebody else. They were written by people like you and me, and then they said, yeah, that's okay to use. They probably didn't say that word for word. So if you want to use a quote from your team captain, a quote from your lead mentor, or you know somebody else that would you know add some interest to the story, you know, and you want to put some of your key, you know, maybe a key fact or a key idea that you want to get in there, and you can put it as a quote. It adds a lot of interest to the story. You know, editors really appreciate that. It you know, because it sort of spices up the way it reads. You know. It's a good idea, obviously, to run it by them and make sure that they're okay with whatever you're saying about them. But, you know, don't be afraid to put that together and then come to them and say, okay, I want to use this quote, is that okay? And so it's a good way to sort of break up, you know, just text that you can. And again, we talked about the boilerplate paragraph. One of the things on the boilerplate paragraph, always include your sponsors. Always include your major sponsors. Again, this is part of giving back to your sponsors. You know, they should be recognized in there if you're sending out a press release. You know, and you may have a kind of a threshold for, you know, which sponsors you're recognizing more than others. You know, you may be not recognizing everybody that gave you $100, but you're probably recognizing the people that gave you $5,000, $10,000. So if your major sponsors are Google or, you know, in our case, University of California Davis, you know, they should be in that boilerplate paragraph and saying who they are. And then, again, we'd like to point of contact and emphasize that enough. They need to know who to call if they have questions. So photographs. It's another way to add interest to your press releases. You know, all of you probably have somebody who's taking pictures of your events. You know, it's always a good idea to include a photograph if you can. Make sure they're good quality photographs, obviously. You want a high resolution JPEG that you can include with the email you're sending along. And you don't want it too big a shot. You know, a shot of the whole field with a bunch of robots and, you know, game pieces and stuff probably isn't going to make it in the newspaper. Something that focuses on a couple of different people, focuses on a couple of key elements, a good shot of your robot in action, that's the kind of thing that's going to make it in the paper. You know, this is a really good example. I mean, in this picture, you've got all the game pieces, you've got the drive team, you know, the drive coach, it's got a team number in it. You know, really couldn't get much better than that. So it really says everything there is to say about the game and, you know, identifies some key people. And so when you show people like this, you need to tell them who they are. Because if they're going to run the caption, they want to run the caption with who's in the picture. So, you know, on here you've got, you know, Kelly, Mike, Julie, Megan. You know, you need to have their names in there, make sure they're spelled right. You probably don't need to give the name to this lady back here because you can't really see her. But, you know, you need to make sure those people who are recognizable and who you want to highlight in your photograph, you've got their names, you've got them spelled properly, and you include that as a caption that goes along with the photo. And always, if you're using, particularly with somebody you don't know, confirm the spelling of their name. There's nothing more embarrassing than sending in a caption with somebody's name misspelled. So, you've written your press release, you've got your photos ready to go. What the heck do you do with it? So, you want to get it out to the press. Well, you don't want to, you know, you should, at the beginning of your season, or, you know, you should have just as an ongoing activity with your business and media team, you should have a press list of your, so these are the people who are going to be on your mailing list for your press releases. So whenever you have something, information you want to get out, things you want to tell them, you've got a list of people to go out to. So these are going to include like probably a wide range of media outlets. Maybe they're not all appropriate for everything you do, but it should be, you know, a wide enough group that you know, for certain things you can either target them or you can send it to everybody on that list. So that's going to include your local newspaper, whether that's a newspaper that's like literally in your town and a daily, or whether it's your regional newspaper, whether it's a daily, weekly, whatever it is that covers everybody in your area. That's probably your primary contact when you're sending out information. Those are the people you probably want to know the most about what you're doing. So, you know, whatever your local newspaper is, whatever one that shows up on your driveway that your parents read, that your friends read, that's the one you definitely want to have. Your school newspaper, obviously having good relationships with your school newspaper editors, making sure that they're covering things, you know, that you've got a relationship with some of the people who are on the newspaper staff. Business publications. Business publications can be really important, particularly, again, go back to sponsors again. So if you've got a story you can pitch to a business publication or tell them about what you're doing and draw the relationship between your team and somebody who's in the business community, you know, business publication might be a good place. Here we have Sacramento Business Journal. I know there's a Business Journal in the Bay Area. There's several business journal publications around the state. There may be other business journals or business publications in your area that you may want to include on your list. Local magazines, sometimes magazines can be good if you have an event that's coming up and you can get it to them early. Magazines have longer lead times, and we'll talk about that in a minute about lead times. So they need to get information like, you know, usually about 2 months ahead of time. Television stations and radio stations can be good opportunities for coverage. We'll talk a little bit more about that too. People who are well-read bloggers or online media outlets in your area, you know, if you have like an online newspaper that's not published or anything, but just online, you know, it's good to include them on your list. It's probably something that has a following. You know, make sure you're contacting them as well. It's not just print media anymore, obviously. So for each one of these, you want to identify a key contact. You want to find out who's the person on that newspaper or at that media outlet that covers what you do. So maybe that's an education writer. Maybe it's a technology writer. Maybe if you're in an area where there's a bigger newspaper that covers your metropolitan region, maybe there's a writer who just covers your neighborhood, you know, or your community. But, you know, look in the newspaper, find out who that person is. You know, go through the newspaper, look at who's in there, who's writing the stories about you, or writing stories about similar activities. You know, and then get in touch with them, get their name, get their email address, you know, get their phone number if you can. But make sure you've got an identified contact for each one. Some publications don't really work that way, and there's more just a general, you know, maybe the general editorial contacts, and maybe there's just a general editorial address that you're going to send your press releases to. Particularly if it's a really small paper, they may, you know, may just go in there and they'll get it in there through a general contact. So you need to find out how they want to get it. Is it a direct email? Do they want you to send it directly to, you know, that specific writer? Does it go to a general email for that department within the newspaper? Or sometimes you go to, there's a place where you would upload it to a certain site on the newspaper's website or the journal's website. So you just need to find out, how do they want to get it? What's the best way to get it in to them so that they're actually going to see it and get it in their hands in a timely fashion? So this takes a little bit of research. You know, like I said, it's an ongoing activity. A lot of these people change all the time. But this should be something as a business media team you should have that goes over from year to year. You know who your contacts are, you know who you're sending your information to and who's out there. And then, you know, every year you're going to want to refresh this. You're going to want to look at and see, are those people still there? Is there somebody else we should be going to or expanding that list? So working with the press. So it's a lot more than just sending stuff out, obviously. What you really want to do, ideally, is try and develop a relationship with a key local writer or editor for your newspaper. Again, particularly your local newspaper, the one that covers the activities that your school does, you know, or covers the activities that are most based in your community. And I kind of threw this up here as an example. You know, we've got a writer over at the Davis Enterprise. It's been a really good contact for several years. We work real closely with her. You know, she gets all our press releases. She follows what the team does. And she, you know, so we make sure that she knows, like, when we go to Champs, that we're going to be there and to follow, you know, what we're doing on Facebook and things like that. And so we've been able to work with her. So she's done a lot of articles on the team, and there are a lot more than just how do we do in competition, you know, what event do we have coming up. You know, she's done some things that are a little bit broader. And this article they did last year when we were working with Digital Minds, which is a team in Woodland that we've helped mentor and get started up. And so she was able to take the information we were sending her about Digital Minds and the new team starting up and really worked it into a great article about what we were doing as a team, the positive things we're doing in community outreach, the things we're doing in working with this other team and another community. It was a great article on the team. And it did a whole lot to raise our, you know, community awareness of what our team was doing and the activities we're involved with. And that really came because we had ongoing, regular communication with her. She knew what we were doing, you know, and we were able to, you know, she was able to talk with us, and we were able to give her more information she knew to go to. So when you're working with the editors, you know, understand what they're interested in. Are they interested in it because it's a technology issue? Is it because it's STEM education? You know, what's their focus? Know their deadlines. This is really important because, you know, they have deadlines. So if you need to have it in by a certain time, you need to have it, you know, I want it on the calendar page so that they know that we're having a fundraiser. You need to know when they have that information by. Typically, it's going to be several weeks ahead of when your event is. Like I said, for magazine, it could be a couple months ahead of when they're going to run it in the magazine. So, you know, find out what their deadlines are. If it's going to go on the calendar page, when do you have to have it to them? And they are deadlines. So, you know, be really timely with that information. And if you're following up on something like a competition and you want to tell them what the results are, you need to get it to them quickly. Because the longer the time goes by from when they actually happen and, you know, when you give them the information, it becomes less and less of a news story. So news, obviously, is what happens right away. So the quicker you can give the information, you know, the better it is for them and the more likely you are to get coverage on it. Real basics, you know, talk a little bit about writing. Check your spelling and grammar. And don't rely on spell checker. Whatever you do, don't rely on spell checker. I mean, I can't tell you how many things that I read that look like they've been spell checked, and, you know, they're the wrong words, they're spelled right, you know, or there's things in there that you know, don't show up on your spell check that aren't really what they intended to write. So, you know, read it very carefully. Be sure that all your words are spelled right. Be sure your grammar is correct. Have somebody else read it for you if you've written it. I mean, this is one of the biggest tips I can give anybody is it's very difficult to edit your own stuff. Always have somebody else take a look at it. Because if you've written it, and you've rewritten it, and, you know, you spent the time to put into it, by the time you've gone through it a few times, you're not reading it anymore. You can't be objective about what you wrote. So hand it to one of your friends on the team. Have them read it through. Have them see if they can pick up anything in there that could be improved, or words are misspelled, or whatever. But it's always good to have somebody else check your work. And then once you send it off to the newspaper, they'll be available to answer questions and provide additional information. Because a lot of times it will follow up. And so, you know, they need to be able to know that you get somebody and you're going to respond to them. And when they get back to you, get back to them right away. That's really important because they're like I said, they're on deadlines. So if they call you and say, I need, you know, some information, I need a contact, I can get a quote, you know, you need to get back to them as soon as you can. So make sure that whoever's your contact is somebody who can respond quickly. So, like I said, pitching a story on your team. And this is kind of beyond just the events and things like that. You know, to get broader coverage of your team, you know, what's interesting about your team. You know, robotics and STEM are big topics right now. I mean, if you look around, every newspaper, every magazine, every media outlet is running articles about STEM and robotics and what's going on in these areas. So there's a lot of interest in it. So there's a lot of opportunities for you to get really good publicity for your team by tying into that. You know, well, like we said, a lot of stuff you're going to do is announcing, you know, recapping your events, you're going to be highlighting your outreach efforts. But each one of you does have a unique story to tell. So whether you're a veteran team, whether you're a brand new team, you know, whether you guys are just kind of like getting restarted again, or whether you've been around and been doing really well for a long time, every team has something different about it that could make a really good story for your local paper, or could make a really good story for a local magazine. You know, so, I mean, these are just, you know, some of the ideas. You know, who's on your team? What's the mixture of your team? You know, girls and boys, the demographics of your team, what communities are you relying on? And how are you organized? Is something that's organized through the school? Are you a class? Are you an after-school activity? You know, what are your challenges and successes? Every team has challenges, right? You know, whether, you know, it's the resources you have, you know, how you overcome that. Those are all really, really good stories. You know, what type of careers your team members are pursuing. You know, a lot of people are looking to go into engineering. Is this a way for them to get into those fields? You know, what's special about your robot? What are you doing in the community? What's your outreach or education? You know, what stories do you have? Because you've all got stories. And so, you know, when you're looking to try and do a little bit more with your press outreach, you know, kind of talk about this and get this information from the other members of your team and you know, come up with some ideas. You know, what are the things that are really unique about your team? Because there are certainly things that you guys can talk about. And you know, and then talk to your, like I said, once you make that contact with somebody in the media, talk to them about it and say, look, you know, here's what's going on with our team. Here's some really cool things that we're doing. You know, again, because this is what I've been working with, you know, Citrus Circuits. 3 years ago, we were working out of a shipping container behind Da Vinci High School. You know, our entire shop was, you know, inside a shipping container. In 3 years, we've gone from that to, and I imagine some of you probably seen, you know, the big shop, new equipment. It's now a class at the high school. We made, you know, huge strides. And that's been a really good story that's been covered very well by the local press. And again, it does a lot to show the growth of the team. It does a lot to show our sponsors, you know, how well things are going. So, you know, you've got those stories. And those are good ways to get yourself covered and get some press. So getting on television. This is something that's a little harder to do, and it takes a lot more effort, but it can pay off really well for you. I mean, you can reach a lot of people, obviously, by being on the news. It's always kind of cool to say, oh yeah, we were on the news last night, or somebody did this, you know, a story on you on the news. Again, there's a lot of built-in interest for robotics. You know, you've got things that move around really fast, you've got kids involved, you've got neat things going on, so it's really works well for television. I mean, you know, it is kind of made for television anyway. There's a lot of good things going on. And particularly with like the, you know, recently with BattleBots and things like that. I mean, as much as that's not what FIRST is about, that certainly raised a lot of people's interest in what's going on with robotics. So they're more likely to cover very specific events that do have a lot of action. I mean, you got to think about what goes on TV, stuff that moves around, stuff that's, you know, interesting. So if you have a competition or you have a community event where there's a lot going on and you've got robot demos and things like that, that's the kind of thing they're likely to come out and cover. So to get covered, you need to take all the right steps. And it does take some work. So this is something that you probably have somebody on your team that's what they're going to, you know, you guys want to, if your goal is we want to be on TV, you're probably going to have one person who's going to dog this and be responsible for it. So the first thing you need to do is, you know, who do you need to talk to? And that's typically what's called an assignment editor. So you're going to have to find out, you know, make a couple phone calls, find out who's the assignment editor for your local TV station. And typically that's going to be like, you can make, maybe if your event's on a weekend, it's going to be a weekend assignment editor. If your event's during the week, it's going to be whoever is there during the week. So generally those are different people. You're going to need to contact them, send them probably a short press release, and you know something with very specifically about times, dates, that type of thing, at least a week prior to the event, so they know it's coming up. You're going to need to follow up with them the day before, say just following up, wanted to know, you know, if you guys will be covering, here's the time, here's my contact. And then the day of the event, you know, it's always good to call and find out, you know, are you coming, can we expect somebody? You know, here's where you can go, here's where we'll meet you. And then when they get there, always have somebody available to work with. So you can't just sort of let them come in and wander around. You really need to have somebody who, if a camera crew does show up, that they can stay with them, they can answer questions, they can point them in the right direction, they can tell them what's important, they can get people that they can interview on camera. So always have somebody who's available to work with them. So, switch gears a little bit here. I want to just kind of on the last part of this, talk a little bit about some of the other channels that you have available to you. You know, we touched on earlier, you're developing your team newsletter. And, you know, this is where you're really going to connect with, you know, and I'm sure most of you have just, how many of you guys have a newsletter, team newsletter you send out? Several? Okay, so the others, I'm guessing you guys don't have a team newsletter? Okay. So, team newsletter is a really easy way to connect with your community, okay? And that community is, you know, your parents, your former team members, your sponsors, community leaders, you know, people who you want to know what's going on. It's something that ideally you send out monthly, maybe you send out quarterly, but it's a really good way to get out to sort of, you know, information about the team. It can be very informational. You know, you want it to be informative. You can use it to, you know, tell them what's coming up, you can tell them what you've done, you can use it to profile some of your key team members or your mentors, you know, again, tell your story, tell the story of your mentors, tell the story of your team members, and who are they, what are they doing, what are they going to do, you know, where are they going to college, what are they looking for as a profession. Highlighting your sponsors, you can even do interviews with your sponsors, you know, you could do an article in there about, you know, who's one of your major sponsors, get somebody from them to come and talk to you and, you know, write it up in your newsletter. Again, it's a way of paying back your sponsors. It's the style of writing is more casual and it's more informative. More personal than press releases. So you know, you can take a few more liberties with the way you write. It's going to be, you know, kind of a little bit more, you know, conversational maybe. But and you're also going to a more informed audience. So the people you're getting to are people who know you. You know, like I said, they're your former team members or your parents. You know, whoever it is you're going out to. And your newsletter really is a big part of, again, supporting your sponsorships, supporting your fundraising. Because, you know, not to be honest about it, you know, where's a lot of your fundraising, where are you going to raise funds from? You're going to raise funds from your parents. You're going to raise funds from your former team members. Hopefully they've all gone on to wonderful things and are making lots of money and are more than happy to give it to you. You know, you want to continue relationships with your sponsors so that they continue to sponsor you year after year. The key community members, you want to keep those relationships. Maybe they know people who want to sponsor you. Maybe they want to be involved with the team as a sponsor or donate at a fundraiser. So newsletters are a really good way to do that because you control the content. You don't have to go through anybody else. You don't have to wait for it to be published anywhere. You publish it, you send it to who you want to. You know, you can include photos, you can include, like I said, interviews, you can include whatever is in there that's interesting about your team. And it's a great way where you control the way to tell your story. So So if you're not doing a newsletter, I really encourage you to do a newsletter. It's a great way to communicate and support what you're doing. Your website. Okay, so who has a website? Okay, so Priya kind of has a website, not really a functional website.
We need to update it badly.
Okay, well, and that's pretty typical, really. So your website's really your face of the team, the rest of the world. I mean, that's probably where a large amount of the people who know about you are going to find out information about you. They're going to go to your website, and they're going to see what's up there. So it's really important that your website represents your team well. Again, it's a place where you control the content. You can control the content that you want to have available to people and what you want them to know. And it's a way to expand a lot of that, too, because obviously this resides there for a long time. But you can have stuff like, you know, your team background, your team history, information on FIRST and links to what they're all about. You can use that press coverage and link it to your website. Photos, videos, promotional videos you do with your team. Highlight ways that people can fundraise. You know, if you're doing crowdsource fundraising or something, you know, there's a way that you can do that through your website. Highlighting your sponsors, again, I know I keep hammering on this, but, you know, having the names of your sponsors up there, having links to their websites, that's, you know, that promotes them and gives back to them for their sponsorship of your team. And then you can post technical resources. I mean, a lot of teams obviously post white papers on different things they're doing, CAD files, programming files, you know, ways that you can share with everybody else in the FIRST community. So there's a lot of things you can do with your website. And again, it's a real key component of what people see about you and what they're going to know about you. And this builds on the content you build from other efforts. And this is something I'm going to kind of hit back on again in a minute. But all of this works together, right? I mean, all of this information works together. So the stuff you use as a press release, you can end up building something from that goes on your website, or that turns into an article that you do in your newsletter. So it's not like you do one thing and it just sort of sits there by itself. I mean, that content can be used in a lot of different ways. So your website in particular, you know, if you've got somebody that's writing articles for your newsletter, use those on your website. And the big critical issue, as you were saying, is it needs to be up to date. I think everybody struggles with this, so not just FIRST teams, but, you know, businesses and everybody else. Keeping your site information up to date is probably one of the biggest pitfalls. It's one of the easiest things to neglect, and it really hurts you in the long run. So, you know, what you need to do is whoever's on your business media team, somebody needs to take responsibility for that website. And on a regular basis, they need to, you know, review the content, update it, make sure that if you've got information on events coming up, that once the event is done, it's moved off of where it is, and it goes into your history, or it disappears, or whatever you're going to do with it. That whether the content on there is current, that it changes on a regular basis, that you're adding new things in all the time. So, you know, I think you've all had the experience, right? I mean, you go to a website to get information on something, you realize the last time they updated it was 2 years ago. And so, you know, it's kind of disappointing. You're not really getting the newest information. You're not really finding out what's going on. So keeping your website updated is really important. And somebody has to take the lead on that. Somebody needs to be responsible, and you need to have a plan for regularly looking at it, you know, every week, every month, whatever it is, and somebody goes through and makes sure that everything is up to date and refreshed. So social media opportunities, and I'm going to spend a lot of time on this, but so who has Facebook pages for your team? Great. Who has Twitter accounts for your team? Okay. Are there any other social media channels you guys use?
Instagram.
Okay. So, are there any other ones other than Instagram you guys have?
YouTube
channel, yeah. YouTube channel is a great way to get information out there. So all those things, those are all part of your communication strategy, right? That all goes together with all of those. The great thing about those, particularly like Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, people get to see what you're doing in real time. So, you know, if you're in a competition, you can be updating your Facebook with how you're doing. You know, what matches are coming up, what place are you in, you know, what's going on. They're great opportunities to communicate with people. They're accessible by pretty much everybody. Your parents can read it. Other students can read it. You know, your friends, your community members, everybody who knows who you are you know, probably on your website or other places, you know, you're going to post whatever your links are to your Facebook page, your Twitter feed, you know, your Instagram, so that they can follow you on those. Again, it's probably the one you're most familiar with. It's probably the one I'm least familiar with. But it's the, you know, you guys know how to use this. It's short, it's conversational, it's immediate. But like we said before, you know, you need to be professional. You need to know that your parents are reading it. You need to know that your friends are reading it. You need to know that your school administrators are reading it. Which then kind of says you need to limit who's accessing it. So, you know, if you're going to use those kind of social media outlets, probably you've got one or two people who are going to be responsible for it. Because that way you can control your content and you control, you know, what gets out there and make sure you don't make any missteps with it. And again, it's meant to keep the content current. If you're going to use Twitter, if you're going to use Facebook, make sure it's constantly updated. You know, there should be something new on there all the time. I know with ours, I think our Twitter feed is linked to our Facebook, so if we're posting on Facebook, it's coming on Twitter. So that helps to keep that fresh. But, you know, people aren't going to look at your content unless there's new content to look at. So be sure that you've got somebody who's updating those constantly and is responsible for it. So, yeah, make all your communications work together. So when you develop it for one thing, it can easily be used for something else. You know, you're going to put a lot of time in this. To develop this, you know, if you're going to put up a video on your team and it's going to be on YouTube, post it on your website. You know, if you're going to do a press release, put the press release up there. Or, you know, develop it into a story that can go into your newsletter, or take the newsletter articles and put them on your website. You know, if you've got newspaper coverage, link to it on Twitter, link to it on Facebook so that people can find it from there and see what's going on. So all these things work together. So it's not like, you know, you're creating individual content for each channel you're using. You know, all these things can work together. So, you know, you put a lot of time into it, so it's good to get the most use out of it that you can. You know, so if you've got that, then reuse it. So it's really important, you know, coordinate among the people who are developing the content and are responsible for these different channels so you guys are consistent. You know, number one, you're not wasting time developing the same thing over and over again. And number two, make sure you're consistent. So your message is consistent and your information is consistent. So consistency. So maintaining a consistent brand. So this is a little different take on some of this, but it's really important that you do maintain a consistent look and feel between all these different platforms you're using. You don't want them to look wildly different from each other. You know, you should be using the same logo on each one. You should be using the same color scheme on each one. You know, your use of photos and graphics should be consistent. Because this is part of, like, if you're looking at, you know, some of the awards, the First Media and Technology Award, if you're looking at going after that, and we'll talk about that again in a minute. You know, one of the requirements on there is be consistent in your messaging. You know, because that way it's, you know, to use a phrase that probably got overused too much, it's how you build your brand, right? People look on there and they see it and they know it's you. You know, they know what it looks like, and they know what they're going to expect. So, you know, make sure that when you look at all these different areas, make sure they're consistent. They're not going to be identical because obviously each one you're using is different ways that you have to set them up. But you want them to look the same. And you want to know that when people look at it, they know that it's you. You know, one thing you probably want to do, and we talked a lot about here too, is, you know, protect your logo. Your logo is what it is. You know, you probably want to stick with it. You don't want to, you know, over the short run, mess around with it a lot. Example I always like to use is, you know, you've all seen the Pepsi logo. Well, a number of years ago, I was working on a project that was going to incorporate the Pepsi logo in some signage. And the guy from Pepsi comes by, and their book, literally book for how to use their logo, is about that thick. I'm not joking. I mean, it is everything about what the colors are, how the colors are used, you know, what you can do, a lot of what you can't do, you know, you can't spin it around, you can't turn it into a ball, you can't, you know. So there's all these different things that they want you to do and not do with their logo. And you should be this, you should have the same level of, you know, you should feel the same level of protection about your logo too. You know, that's who you are, that's part of your brand. And so you want to use that logo consistently, you don't want to have it manipulated too much, you know, keep control over it. So communications are key to your team's success. And as I started out saying, I know a lot of people, if you're in business and media, you often don't feel like maybe you're, you know, you often don't feel like you're the most important part of the team. But it's really quite the opposite. You know, you are really key to everything that the team does. And your communication strategy is really key to what everything your team does. And when I was thinking about this, it's kind of like the old phrase, you know, if a tree falls in the forest, does it really make, and nobody hears it, does it really make a sound? Well, it's kind of like, you know, if a robot falls in the competition, you know, but nobody talks about it, did it really happen? Now, obviously, there's a lot of things that are great about what, you know, just being on the robotics team and, you know, building a robot and being competitions are good all in and of themselves. But quite frankly, you lose a lot of opportunities if you're not communicating that. If you, you know, you, what you do on public relations and communications supports getting that robot on the field. You know, if you don't communicate what you're doing, it's going to hamper your fundraising efforts, it hampers your sponsorships, it hampers your recruitment. You know, if you're going to get a good robot on the field, it takes money. And to get money to raise, you know, raise money for your team, people have to know what you're doing. They have to know what your successes are. You have to be able to prove to sponsors that you're doing something great with their money. You know, if you're going to have new students, if you're going to continue the success of your team, you need new students coming in. So they need to know what you're doing. They need to know how exciting it is to be a part of the team. They need to know why they want to be a part of the team. So they need to know what you're doing. You know, if you're interested in awards programs, every single one of the awards programs, whether it's chairman's or media and technology, or in most of the other programs that are through FIRST, you have to be able to prove what you're doing. You know, how do you prove what you're doing? It's through your communications activities. It's through what you get in the press. It's what you have in the newsletter. It's what you have on your website. You know, it's the information you develop about your team as you're going on. And that supports all your ability to prove, you know, what you're doing for awards program. Again, community support and involvement, really important to the team. You know, how does the community know about you? It's through what you do in your communications efforts. And your outreach and education. You know, you're going to get more people involved with your outreach and education. You're going to get more people to, you know, if you're doing like summer camps or something like that, they have to know they're going on. And that takes a lot of support from media and communication. So, you know, you are really the most important part of your team in a way. Because, you know, there's a lot of work that goes into the robot, but getting that robot on the field and being able to take advantage of that is really a lot to do with your communications efforts and your public relations efforts. So some resources if you're looking for, you know, more ideas or more background and things like that. And these slides will all be posted on our website later on, just so you know, for actually all the talks that we're doing. They're going to be up on our website hopefully soon, but we'll have them up there. So the first, there's some information on the FIRST Media and Technology Innovation Award. In there, there's the criteria, and it's part of the, it's one of the chapters there in the FIRST Robotics Competition Manual. And like most awards programs, it's really not so much about winning the award, it's really about how do you structure a good program. And so if you go in there and you look at it, it's really focused on, you know, websites, social media, all the ways that you communicate electronically. And you know, just look in there and what the criteria is. And if you work to address those criteria, you're going to build a really strong program. Because that's what it's there for. It's giving you a framework. So it's a good idea to take a look at that. And that'll give you some good ideas for your website, your Facebook pages, your other social media outlets. And how do you tie those together? How do you make them strong? How do you use them to communicate effectively? The FIRST Regional Planning Guide, the Annual Media PR Toolkit. Section 10 in there, and that's under the regional resources, is all about the things you do to promote an individual competition. There's sample press releases in there, and there's information about how to work with press. There's some really, really good background. I mean, FIRST makes a lot of resources available, and I think most of us don't take advantage of those enough. But, you know, if you poke around their website, there's a lot of good stuff on there. But if you look at that regional planning guide manual, that PR section is really good information, provides some good outline. There's a couple of good articles too, and there's a non-engineering mentors organization. Non-engineering mentors organization. It's for people like me that aren't engineers and aren't technical, but are involved as mentors. And there's a couple of things posted on there again, just some good general information about how to work with the media and, you know, how to be effective. So there are a lot of things out there. So with that, if you guys have any questions, hopefully you have some questions. Any questions? I've answered all your questions about media and communication. Yeah?
So like, if you're going to email the press, do you start out with, do you just email them the press release, or do you email them beforehand, so like how to like send the press release?
You know, it's not a bad idea to try and contact them ahead of time, whether it's, you know, pick up the phone and call them, or, you know, send an email ahead of time and say, hi, I'm, you know, the business media lead for our local robotics team. You know, would we like to publicize our upcoming events? Are you the best person to talk to? And how would I do that? You know, and you know, it may take a couple of tries to get to the right person, but yeah, it's a good idea to kind of establish that up front if you can. Like I said, some newspapers and things may just have a more general, it's just like, you know, send it to events at, you know, palooalameeting.com or something. But yeah, it's a good idea to try and first make contact with them and get a name and make a connection with that person. Anything else? So if you do have any questions, I'm, you know, be happy to talk with you afterwards. I'll be around today and tomorrow if there's anything you want to ask or, you know, talk about what we're doing or what you're doing. Be happy to talk to you about it. And really pleased you're all able to come today. And thanks for being here for us. And enjoy Capital City Plaza.
Thank you.